Hello everyone, welcome to the Malta Sustainability Forum. You're attending the first track of today, which is about leading with purpose. In this track, we're going to discuss the importance of corporate purpose, why corporate purpose today needs to focus on solving our sustainability problem, and what we need to do as management to make purpose work. The agenda is simple. We're going to start with two presentations to set the scene, and then we're going to hear from a number of business leaders how they define, manage, and implement their purpose strategies. Please welcome the panelists of today's track. We have Maria Mikhalev, who is the CEO of the General Soft Drinks Company and the Waterfront Hotel. Welcome, Maria. We have Franco Azzopardi, who is the chairman and CEO of Express Trailers. Welcome, Franco. We have Mark Weingart, founder of Inalia and Inspirasia Foundation. Welcome, Mark. And then we have Nikhil Patil, who is the CEO of Go. Welcome, Nikhil.
Thank you, Wim.
And I'm Wim Vermeulen. I'm the Director of Strategy and Sustainability of a company called Bookka, which is a company that helps other companies define and implement communication strategies. Great. So again, welcome everyone. I'm going to start with a short presentation to set the scene and to talk about sustainability. All right, thank you very much. Can we have the next slide? Thank you. Okay. So what is corporate purpose today? Well, the definition of corporate purpose today is basically very simple. It's where what you do as a company meets with what society needs you to do. And answering the question, what society needs you to do today is very simple. Next slide, please, is to help solve the sustainability issue that we have. And we know that that has to do with our economic model, because our economic model brings two sustainability problems. The first one is linked with our emissions, and that gives us global warming. And the second one is that our economic model is working really hard for a few of us, but not so hard for the rest of us. And so basically what we need to do for the future is we need to decouple growth, economical growth, from the negative impact it has today. Next slide, please. So if we talk about sustainability, what is at stake for humanity? It's an important question, because today we hear people talk about the end of the planet or the end of humanity. But basically, it's not that. It's not the end of the planet. It's not. We are not going to go extinct. The real sustainability issue is the risk of making lives of millions of people very difficult in the near future. And so it has to do with our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren. And the real question is, are we willing to take the risk of making the lives of our great-grandchildren really very difficult in the near future? That is what is at stake for us and for humanity. For businesses, however, something else is at stake. Can we have the next slide, please? Thank you. If we ask the business world what they define as the 10 most important global risks of doing business, then you see it there. If you look at the red ones, that's societal, and the green ones, that these are risks that has to do with the environment. But if you look at the total, then you see that 7 out of 10 of those global risks are caused by sustainability, yeah, by the sustainability issues. So for businesses, what's at stake for businesses, basically, and if you put it black and white, it's their future. Because every business needs to start recognizing the risk for their business and needs to manage the risk, because the risks are huge. Can we have the next slide? Thank you. And if we look at how businesses are doing, and we look at the impact of businesses on climate, then we see that as of today, if we don't do anything, then businesses only, so not governments, businesses only will bring us to a global warming of +4 degrees in 2100. If we look at all European businesses as it stands today, they will cause a global warming of 3.5 degrees. Now, what you have to know is, if we end up in 2100 in a world that is +3 degrees, basically we turn our world into a very unlivable planet with massive migration to the Arctics, with food issues, a lot of food issues. We won't be able to feed humanity, et cetera, et cetera. So basically, you don't want to end up in a world of more of 3 degrees of global warming. That is why if we look at the Paris Agreement and the SDGs, the goal, the global goal, is to limit global warming to 1.5, well below 2% or 1.5 degrees. Okay, can we have the next slide? So that is what, so if we ask ourselves, what is it that society needs companies to do, that is to limit their negative impact, social and environmental. So every company by 2030 or by 2040 needs to be on track to have a net positive impact on social and environmental, and cannot have negative impact. By 2050, we need to end up at net zero for all businesses, for all of society. And so there we need to be at, as I said, net zero, which means no negative impact. Next slide. All right. So the question is, what is the outcome of corporate purpose today? It's very simple. Your purpose must ensure that it leads your company to being net positive as soon as possible. And as soon as possible means between 2030 and 2040. Next slide. Okay. The good thing is, if we look at companies that are already doing that, so the proxy for being net positive is scoring high on ESG, environmental, social, and governance criteria. If you look at those companies and you compare the financial results of those companies with companies that are not scoring well on ESG, then you see the companies that score well, they have a 40% better financial results. So basically what this says is it says that it pays off to have a net zero strategy. So it pays off. So it's very, very important that you make purpose work. And there's a very simple way to understand if your purpose works within your company. Can we have the next slide? Thank you. And basically, when purpose works, then four things happen. The first one is people on the floor see their C-suite lead by example. The second thing that happens is that people on the floor trust the purpose strategy and find it credible. The third thing that happens is it creates friendly peer pressure. So that means that, on the floor, in the daily decisions, people are taking into account the purpose strategy. And if they don't, that, colleagues are gently pushing them to do so. And the fourth thing is there's a lot of quick wins and progress to show for. And if those four things happen, then you know that your purpose works. I want to stress the second one, earning trust and credibility, because the credibility issue is a big one. Can I have the next slide? Thank you. This is from a research I've done in May of last year. And the question was, a lot of companies and governments are talking about their sustainability efforts. And the question was, do you believe them? And you see the results. There's a big gap of belief, of trust. people simply do not believe companies that say, you know, that talk about their efforts. They do not believe the governments. They believe scientists. Okay, so and that's it's a very important takeaway, because it means that, you know, if you communicate, if you try to implement your purpose strategy, then, you know, you need to, your starting point should be people will not believe me. Yeah? And if you do that, then you know, you have a better chance of having this, the four things of the former slide happen. Now, on this credibility, why is building credibility so important? Because if you don't, then this happens. Can we have the next slide? Yes, and this happens. So there's a lot of people, right, employees saying, yes, we have a corporate purpose. 76% says they work in a company with a corporate purpose, but only 10% say that it's being systematically activated. So if there's no credibility, this is what happens. And then you know that your purpose strategy will slowly die. Now, to build that credibility, there are three things. Can we have the next slide? There are three things that are very important, and you have to have those three. You can't do two. Oh, sorry. Can we have, yes, okay, thank you. Yeah, so you have to have the two. You can't survive with one or two, but you have to have the two if you want to build sustainability. So it's a real trilemma. First of all, you have to have the commitment, you know, and you have to show commitment. It's a little bit like Patagonia. Patagonia is showing commitment on a daily, you know, on a every day. So it's really important that the C-suite is showing commitment in everything that they do. And then the corporate strategy or your sustainability efforts need to create the right value. And that's an important one too. I'm going to give you the example of Nespresso. The coffee brand Nespresso has a huge program of planting trees. They're planting millions of trees. Now, out of research, when you go to the consumer of Nespresso and you ask the consumer if there's any value in them planting millions of trees, consumers are like, well, we really don't understand why they're planting trees, because, you know, in our view, they are creating huge waste problem with their cups. So they should concentrate on solving the waste issue. And you know, and planting trees is not that, so that is not that important for Nespresso. So, and there you see a clear value gap. The company is doing one thing and the consumers are saying, yeah, it's all well, but you know, it's not the core thing that you need to do. And so if you want to create value, you have to make sure that you create the right value. And the third one is proof. You know, you have to have a track record, and especially if you are a company in transition, which is, you know, 99% of all companies are in transition, then you have to build a track record, because otherwise people won't believe you. So that's basically the sustainability trilemma. If you want to build up credibility, you have to show commitment, you have to create the right value, and then you have to show the track record. Okay, thank you very much. Great. As I showed, sustainability has two aspects. It's about climate, but it's also about the social impact. Now, Mark Weingart and his Inspirasia Foundation is very focused on generating social impact. And so in the next 10 minutes, Mark will take us through a presentation that shows us how he does that. Now, Mark was flying this morning, so we weren't, he's here, but we weren't sure that he would be here on time. So we have pre-recorded his presentation, and we're going to take a look at it now.
Hi, I'm Mark Weingart. I'm an entrepreneur, a philanthropist, as well as being a family man and an avid football fan. To lead is to show people the way. And you cannot show the way if you don't know where you want to go to. You can lead by example, you can lead with a firm hand, but remember, you can also lead blindly. So for leadership to be successful, the leader must have direction and must be able to show others that direction. I want to firstly ask a question. Can a business that is run only with a profit motive be successful? And my answer is yes. You don't need to be altruistic to be a success. Your business doesn't need to have a positive social impact. In fact, if you're paying your taxes, you're profitable, you're creating employment, then you're helping society. Your employees are being given a way to feed their families, your social security payments are paying for their future, and your corporation tax and VAT payments are helping fund the wider community. So this begs the question, why should my business have a purpose other than profit? This other purpose is sometimes wrongly called a higher purpose. We should always remember as business people, profitability is a primary purpose and must not be forgotten in the search for social good. And we must never belittle the business people who are only focused on making money, for they're still contributing to society. I'd like to put forward the idea that we should try to lead with extra purpose. Extra purpose is what makes us happy. It's what makes us feel alive, what makes us feel valuable, and it's what makes our employees feel proud and our customers feel valued. It's this extra purpose that creates fulfillment. It's this extra purpose that differentiates the ordinary from the extraordinary. There's nothing wrong with being ordinary, but you never remember the ordinary days, the ordinary people, ordinary meal that you ate. We always remember the extraordinary. So leading with purpose should be renamed leading with extra purpose. Extraordinary business people change societies. They are the ones that innovate. They are the ones that inspire. They are the ones that are making a difference to them, those around them. I started giving to charitable causes in a meaningful way back in 2001. I was in New York, I was due in the World Trade Center for a meeting, but because we had some technical issues, I didn't make the meeting. This was September the 11th. This was the day when the plane hit the building. It was one of those days where I realized that, you know, I had to do something with my life. I decided to give the following week's revenues from my business to the victims. What I didn't realize is that our revenues would quadruple. I didn't realize that my customers would be happier to work with us and my employees would work harder. You know what? They all wanted to do something extraordinary. A year later, I lost my girlfriend in a terrorist attack. And then 2 years later, I was in the tsunami in Thailand. Each time, I decided to give a portion of our revenues to charity. And each time we grew. I set up a charitable foundation in 2003. And I'm very happy to tell you that since then, I've given over 10 million euros to charitable causes. And this has been raised by our companies. This is not us going out and asking for money. Whether we're funding prosthetic limbs or organizing charitable concerts, we're making a social difference. I arrived in Malta 8 years ago. From the beginning, our businesses gave back to the community. We helped the local school. We participated in lots of local social projects. This led to us being better accepted by the business community of Malta. It allowed us to show social leadership. The people who work for Inniala and our customers feel an affinity to us because we're not just focused on profitability. We have been profitable in Malta. If we were not, we wouldn't gain their respect. We have not just come to Malta with profit in our mind. We've tried to create a social dividend. We started the Social Impact Awards in Malta in 2016. It's a competition to find a good social impact project. And once we find a winner, we give that project a grant so it can be fulfilled. This year, we're about to have our finals in March. There's lots of social ideas that have been put forward, but we're looking for that one project that will make a long-term social difference. Over the last 5 years, we've given about 500,000 euros to different social projects in Malta. And we intend to launch an Academy of Philanthropy and a philanthropy consultancy later in 2021. It will reach out to businesses with a presence in Malta, as well as wealthy individuals, and help them understand their social purpose and help them realize that purpose. We are looking for 8 businesses now to be guinea pigs. We're going to run a philanthropy and CSR mentoring program and a series of business breakfasts. And we're looking for 8 organizations or individuals who'd like to develop their social leadership. If this could be you or your organization, please contact me at mark@inniala.com. In business, it's important to lead with purpose. The first purpose of our business must be profitability. The extra purpose is what will differentiate you from the others. I know that there are many companies that are here in Malta that are focused on making a difference, but we need more of them. Extraordinary businesses create a more caring society and a better society. So my message for you is lead with purpose, let that purpose be profit, but also be extraordinary leaders and try and change the world around you for the better. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark. Now, I'm now going to open the floor to the panel. As you know, we have Maria Mikhalev, Franco Azzopardi, Mark, which you have just seen, and Nikhil Patil. All right, welcome everyone. Welcome online, welcome in the studio. The first question to you in the panel, and this is a question for everyone, is could you define or share with us what your corporate purpose is and why you decided on the one you have? Okay, Maria, could you explain a little bit about your purpose?
Sure, Wim. Good afternoon, everybody. Well, generous soft drinks, our vision. I have to start off from the vision. The vision is to be the preferred supplier of choice for beverages in the community that we operate in. In order to achieve this vision, we need to have a growth mindset. In order to have such a growth mindset, we need to understand the impact that we create on the ecosystems that we operate in. This awareness is important so that we, as Mark said, we do business not the easy way, but the right way. The way that we have defined our corporate purpose is to make sure that our objectives are linked to the sustainability goals of the three main areas that we consider to be impactful, which is the product, the planet that we operate in, and people. In the case of product, we define goals when it comes to the sugar content of our products, which is an important impact on obesity and the issues of obesity. Water is the major ingredient of our products, and hence water replenishment is very important. And when it comes to the planet, we are aware of the impact of waste generated through our packaging. When it comes to people, we are aware of the inequality issues that are facing us, and we try to drive diversity both in the employee force that we employ, as well as in the communities that we operate in. And we also are all very focused on female empowerment and making sure that there are that we empower women to reach economic targets defined in our global strategy. We are also very conscious about the impact on agriculture, and we also have goals related to that. So these are the three main areas which define corporate purpose. And our goals defined in our annual business plans, defined in our KPI matrices, are linked to these corporate purposes.
All right, thank you. Nikhil, can you explain a bit your purpose strategy and how do you decide it on the one you have?
Yeah, I think, like you mentioned, if you look at the two big challenges humanity faces today or opportunities, is one is tackling climate change, and another is increasing social inequality. The third big force, which COVID has made it even more apparent, is the way digital is reshaping our lives. It changes the way we are working, we rest, we play, we interact with each other. It's quite apparent that it's increasingly becoming a fundamental enabler of the way we live, and it's important for our current and future well-being. We believe that not everybody is benefiting evenly from the digital revolution. You know, today, access to digital infrastructure and skills is key to a good life. And that basically underpins our purpose. So if I had to state our purpose is to drive a digital Malta where no one is left behind. Driving a digital Malta, the first part is really about having the best infrastructure and getting people connected to what matters to them. But if at the end of the day, if all we did was allow people to watch more and more Netflix, then we would have failed. That's where the part no one left behind comes in. We challenge ourselves to find ways in which we can get everyone online, but go beyond that. But big part of that is actually how do we create access to digital skills so people can participate in the digital economy? And then going one step beyond is how do we create jobs in the digital economy beyond normal employment? For example, we started Go Ventures once we defined our purpose. And the whole idea is not only to fund startups, but to actually at least create 30 to 50 jobs every year in the local economy, which are linked to digital. So in a way, our purpose to a certain extent is our North Star. It defines our strategy, it defines our culture, but it also defines where we make our investments. And I think Mark said it right about profit. It's not, we care a lot about profits, but our philosophy is that profits is like the oxygen we need to breathe. But if you ask me, do I live to breathe oxygen? I'd probably say not. And that's how we strike a balance between, or at least show the difference between purpose and profit. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Mark, anything you want to add to that?
Well, I think that for us as a company, we, you know, the corporate purpose is just part of our DNA. The way, I wouldn't say that we have a corporate purpose statement. We very much as an organization, community runs through our blood. We try to do everything that we're doing with community in mind. So for example, over the next few months, we're going to do 3 charity dinners, which are going to raise money for different charitable causes. So all of our staff in our company will actually be taking part in something, giving back to the community. There are customers who are coming in. They're going to be coming in into some charity dinners, and they're going to understand that, you know, that they are giving back as well. And, you know, as part of our statements as a business is that we want to raise the bar. We want to create real luxury in Malta. But the important thing is that we're a bit of a Robin Hood company. You know, we, you know, we're there, you know, talk about luxury and everything else, but we take from the rich, we give back to the poor, we give back to the needy. And I think that that it just runs through our DNA. We don't need to state it as a corporate purpose statement. The people understand it because they're acting. Actions speak louder than words. And when we do things, that's when our employees and that's when our customers understand things.
Okay, Mark, very quickly, you are the founder of a company. How is that different from, you know, being a CEO of a company that you don't own?
Well, I think as a founder of a company, you do what you want. So we're not a public listed company at the moment. And I suppose that anyways, we can actually go out there and do what you want. So, you know, anyways, we can buy a lot of, you know, the stuff that happens if you are in a company. I think that you can do as much as you wish, but then your board of directors will actually maybe put some of the direction in place. So I think that actually when you have your own business, you're much more able to control your corporate purpose. So I think that as a CEO, you can change your corporate purpose and you can go out and create, lead with purpose for sure. But I think it's a lot easier when it's your own business.
Yes. All right. Okay. Franco, you're in the studio. Same question for you. For your company, what's your corporate purpose and why did you decide it on the one you have?
Thank you, Wim. Well, I'll just relate to you a small story of when I was offered the job to join the company around 10 years ago. At that time, I was an avid cyclist. And to me and to my mind, trucks and trailers, they were a nuisance. Road pollution, you know, danger on the roads. I had no esteem whatsoever for the transport industry. So it was a bit of a challenge trying to understand whether this was a job that fits me or whether it's something that is completely alien to my lifestyle and all. So I spoke to the board of directors, who were also the owners, and these guys were in the third generation. So immediately to my mind came, you know, the father sows, the son reaps, the grandson consumes, and then, you know, everything dismantles. So that was already a bit of a challenge for me to try and reconcile with these gentlemen. However, the one question I put, which is related and comes nicely into the topic, is what do you want of me? What do you want of this company? Do you want, I mean, you're being in the third generation, do you want to milk the cow dry and, you know, end it? And they said, no, we want a company that endures. We want a company that will endure to future generations. And that is what excited me. I said, over here, we probably have a challenge. So, I joined, and my mission at that point in time was to actually instill amongst these people a sense of purpose, to actually create this durability they wanted out of the company, by actually instilling a sense of sustainability. You can't have anything that is durable that is not sustainable. Now, the transport industry is pretty tricky because we depend on the latest technologies that are around in terms of engines, in terms of consumption, in terms of, yes, pollution. But there's a lot of development going on. And the first thing that we did is that our investment plan is such that we change all our vehicles to the latest engine technology. So most of our, we have 6 kilometers of equipment on the road. So bumper to bumper, it's quite a lot of vehicles. And most of them are Euro 6 engines. That's the latest we can find at this point in time. Sprinter vans are electric vehicles. But the most important thing, apart from the investment in hardware, is the mindset that I wanted to instill in the people, starting from the entrepreneur, from the owner, right down to the flag bearer, who is the helper, who is the driver, who is the trucker. And we came up with this hashtag, We Are Orange. I know that Nick Hill would be, you know, he's orange as well. And we also have this Leave No One Behind, which we coined very staunchly when the COVID struck, the pandemic struck. There was a knee-jerk reaction. You know, the investors were perhaps saying, you know, we should not renew contracts. Maybe we should consider 4-day week. Transport we got a hit of around 40% in the initial, the first quarter. So it was a big challenge. But I must say that with the right mindset that we had invested in together, the investor understood that he is the entrepreneur and it's not the employee who is the entrepreneur. And we really left no one behind. So COVID was the litmus test, so to speak, of what we had invested in over the past decade. Since we tried to instill proper governance in the company, this was, you need to understand this company I work for, Express Trailers. Yes, it's a 50-year-old company, family business, 8 brothers, you know, the father was the founder, and now there are the children of those brothers who are working in the company. Today, we are just shy of 300 people. So it's a bit of a complex family-owned and there's participation also in management by family. So yeah, I think that overall we established the purpose even in the subconscious, but truly ingrained in the hard-coded in the bones of the company.
All right, thank you very much. Let's talk about the finance bit. Let's talk about profit. You talked about the shareholders. We know that, you know, investors are keen to solving a sustainability issue because they have to allow their companies to prioritize their sustainability efforts. Now, let's talk about finance. So, Maria, a question for you. Your purpose strategy, your sustainability plan, how does that drive your financial results and how do you define success?
Okay, I will recall, I'd say I will relate two key processes that we've been implementing at General Soft Drinks. The first one is a program that has been ongoing for 10 years, related to water sustainability. In 2011, we started in Malta a water sustainability program. Malta, the economies of scale on a global environment are what they are, very small, challenges of returning money to the shareholder, as we rightly say, but also being very conscious that if we do not create an impact on the environment that we work, then regulations will heavily tax our industry. So water being one of the major ingredients that we use in our products, and we are one of the extraction the people who extract water from the aquifer, we realized that it was a challenge. So we wanted to make sure that communication was clear. We are only responsible for extracting less than 1% as a whole industry of water from the water table. However, we wanted to have to attract investment in Malta to make sure that the water that we are extracting, we are having ways and means of returning the water to Earth. So the first challenge was finding funds. So the whole management team embarked on a program. There exists a foundation in Atlanta where one can apply for funds. And over the last 10 years, we have managed to tap well over 1.5 million euros from Atlanta, from our Atlanta offices, into Malta to create, I would say, three major projects. The first one was water preservation. So we created reservoirs in schools, in public schools. We took some best practices in other islands, in Greece and in Cyprus, and we brought them into Malta to use the runoff of rainwater inside schools and to conserve that water. The second big project, and we have now, I think, around Malta, we have about 10 of such reservoirs inside the schools. We also embarked on water conservation in valleys, and we did a great project in restoring the water within the some valleys in Gozo and in Malta. We also created grey water systems using teaching people how to use grey water within the facilities they operate. We have a grey water system in Gozo and two in Malta. We also embarked in restoring a number of reservoirs. For example, we restored the reservoir at our at the residence of the president in San Anton, where we restored the reservoir, which dates back from the time of the Knights of St. John, and which on an annual basis gathers enough water to conserve the orchards there. So during the course of the 10 years, we have created projects that now mean that we save 18,000 cubic meters annually of water. We have created pride and credibility among our workforce and consciousness, both at education levels, embarking also with Nature Trust and other entities in Malta to continuously educate our children to have a better appreciation of this very important resource. So I do believe that if you had to tell me the financial impact on our business, I see that if we did not do anything ourselves, there would have been regulatory, the governments that we are operating would have set a regulatory framework to tax our business if we did not do anything about it to combat the situation. Another project that now we have, it's our new pet project that we've embarked on since 2016, since there was the since Malta hosted the Ocean Conference. We hear about the impact of packaging of the products we sell on the environment. So all, you know, our beverages are sold in PET bottles and cans and in glass bottles. And each package has an impact on the environment if it is not collected in the right way and recycled. So here we started in 2016 by owning this, leading a coalition between all the producers, importers and retailers in Malta, working hard with government to have a legislation, go to the EU, get the legislation through the EU. And now we're at the stages that in 18 months time, 14 to 18 months time, we're going to have basically a system which will ensure that all packages in Malta are collected and recycled, creating green jobs and also achieving our targets.
All right, thank you very much. It's interesting you talk about regulations. What we're going to see this year is we have the COP26 in September, where all nations that signed the Paris Agreement will come together and increase their efforts. And what all experts are waiting for or think that's going to happen, because all countries will have to raise their efforts, that we're going to have a storm of regulations to force businesses to fit the plans. So you're right, if companies don't act by themselves, they will be hit by a lot of regulations to force them to cut their emissions, etc. I just heard that we are in the audience are about 100 people. Here you have a panel of business leaders. So if you have questions on purpose for one of the business leaders, please send them in. Because at the end, we're going to have 10 minutes to take questions from the audience. So please ask your question and then ask them who do you want from the panel to respond to your question. Nikhil, a question for you about the plan to become net positive. You just explained that you work on digital access for everyone, and you don't want to leave anyone behind, which is part of the Sustainable Development Goals. And so, could you talk a little bit about your plan to become net positive and what the major milestones are?
Yeah, so I think if we go back to what you said, the two key factors which contribute to increasing social inequality in the future, I think one is going to be climate change, besides digital. So what we have done is we are adopting the science-based targets initiative. Our plan is to actually reduce our emissions by 21% by 2024 and 42% by 2029. We hope to do better. If I look at last year, our total carbon footprint was about 16,500 tons. Now that number doesn't mean a lot, but it's, to put it in a different way, it's equal to 3,500 average cars running 365 days. And that's the amount of carbon that Go generates. It turns out 85% of our carbon emissions are linked to electricity. Our intention is in the next 5 years to cut it down by 30% to 40%. We have embarked on a 100 million network infrastructure upgrade, which basically we are halfway through. In 4 years' time, every home in Malta will have a fiber. It'll probably be the first European country to have a fiber to the home. But that, what that means is it allows us to switch off our old copper network, switch off our old TV network, which generates a lot of electricity. As we adopt 5G, we will actually use that opportunity to turn off old mobile networks, and that should have a huge impact on our CO2 footprint. Next is we learned from COVID, and we have embarked on a journey where we are a remote-first organization. At Go today, and for the last 1 year, you can work from anywhere, but you can't work from the office for more than 3 days. What that has done is it allowed us to actually cut our real estate footprint by about one third. It's taken down our commute hours, which is a big part of our carbon emissions, to around by 30 to 40%. And to top it all off, we basically are building a new campus where literally it'll be self-sustainable and the electricity will be generated by the walls, not the roof, but the walls of the building. So when I look at the combination of infrastructure replacement, work practices, I think I'm fairly confident that we'll meet our science-based targets. But more importantly, actually laying out infrastructure with fiber to everyone's home, I think supports the wider trend of working from home, which should help the broader society also reduce its commute-based carbon emissions.
All right, thank you. It's very interesting that you touch upon the science-based targets. For the audience, let me explain a little bit why that is so important. The science-based targets, our planet has boundaries. And that's about climate, you know, that's about make the planet work for us. And now, so the scientists, you know, it's about emissions and it's about make sure that we control the runaway climate. And so scientists have, you know, have calculated, for example, how many tons of emissions we can still fire up in the air. That's not so much, you know. But so they have developed science-based targets, and businesses can go to scientists and say, okay, this is, you know, the emissions that my company produces. What do we have to do to bring them down and to make sure that we are on the right track? And those are the science-based targets. So for every company, you know, it's very important that, you know, on climate, that you work with science-based targets, because they will give you the right journey to becoming net zero. Okay. Mark, a question for you. What is it that you do personally? So we've seen in the first presentation that part of the of making purpose work is C-suite showing, you know, showing the way, leading the way. You're the founder of the company. What is it that you do personally to lead on purpose?
I suppose be involved at the forefront and, you know, leading by examples. So, you know, when, you know, I decided then that we needed as a company to give back. So we, as an organization, and decided that we were going to set something called Malta Together. We were going to go out and help all the different people who are out there in Malta get information on, you know, what to do during a pandemic, how they could get food at home, how they can get all different services, get entertainment. And then we organized a concert, which, you know, basically went out and raised a lot of money for needy causes. I got on the phone personally. I got on the phone to all the different leaders of all the businesses. I worked with all of my people. I, you know, regularly spoke to them to say, look, we're doing something important. We're giving back to society. You know, we need to do something. And, you know, it's important to be involved, not just to tell people what to do, but, you know, to lead from the front, to pick up the telephone, to speak to your employees, to make them understand what you're doing. And, you know, it's that participatory nature that for me is very important, you know, in leadership. I think it's very important that, you know, that you need to be seen as a person who's actually going to go out and get your hands dirty, that you're going to be going out and, you know, we'll give money to charity. I'm going to put the first 20,000 in. Are you going to give something? And that's what we need to go out and do. So we, you know, we go out, we give, we talk to people and just get involved very much from the beginning. We plant the seed and hopefully the tree will grow.
All right, thank you. Franco, same question for you. What do you do to lead personally on purpose, and how do you show your commitment to the different stakeholders?
Well, the way I do it is I focus a lot on the governance side of things. I strongly believe that once you've got, you know, the top part of the company and the bottom part of the company interlinked with this, what we call governance, proper governance, with the correct understanding, leading by example. Yes, we do. I mean, I personally even went on a tour with one of the truckers. It's not an easy life, trying to understand. And I understood even more when we have this surreal picture of one of our trucks on M7 in the UK, during the pandemic, solo. Imagine an 8-lane motorway with just one truck on the road. Imagine the trucker being on his own there. If anything had to happen to him, you know, it's. But we did have some difficulties in people wanting to go on the roads and serve the societies, but. One message that we drove through, not only to the general public, but internally, because I strongly believe in the governance side and then the internal communication. And this I own personally, and I do it with a lot of vigor, is that we are serving the societies. Malta is, is surrounded by the sea, and we're isolated. And as long as there are humans living here, there has to be transportation. There has to be transportation of cargo, whatever we see around us, whatever we own, whatever we wear. Probably we carried it because, of course, we're net importers in Malta. So we, our people, this is the message I give them every single day. I mix with my people every day. I'm at the office at 6 o'clock in the morning. I have coffees with the industrialists. And this is the message I give them every time, that we are serving the society. We have a noble mission. We have gained respect for them. Logistics has been given a different dimension. We have invested a lot in our communication out there. And we do get that sort of respect back. I have to admit that, what Mark is saying, that, giving back to society, unfortunately, we're not seen. Express Sailors is not seen as giving back to society, because what we give, we do it silently. We don't believe as a policy that philanthropy has a marketing currency. We don't use it as a marketing currency, but we do help. We know we are a nuisance on the road, so our focus in what we used to call the corporate social responsibility, now we have the ESG and we have other, is that we support inclusiveness in road activities, so in marathons and triathlon events, so as long as it's not a podium elites sport that we support, but we do support organizations that have inclusiveness in their policy, in you know, who is obese, who is fit, who is mature, who is young, gender equality. As long as there are those ingredients in whatever event is being organized, we are there to support. And this we do with persuasion and conviction, and we do it focused to give back something to society for the nuisance we are on the road. So we try and link whatever we give with this type of focus. As I said, it's not a big company. It's by local standards. Yes, it might be considered on the borderline between the medium and the large, but we do our best. And me personally, I feel I am the intermediator, the mentor, the instigator, the designer of these mindsets, linking them, as I said, through proper governance.
All right, thank you very much, Maria. To end up with you. Send to you, what is it that you do personally, and how do you show that commitment to your stakeholders?
We're very much same to what Mark and Franco said before me. I do believe a lot in leading by example. I believe about being hands-on, so leading by example, but by showing the various stakeholders. By stakeholders, I mean our shareholders, our board of directors, our employees, who I believe I can only measure my success or the success in what I'm doing in this regard is creating many ambassadors out there saying the same thing and behaving in the same ways. So I think that the measure of success when we come to leading by example and hands-on approach is how much do we contaminate the people, whether it's employees, whether it is the society we operate in, with our principles, with our objectives, and with the impacts we want to leave on society.
Okay, thank you. Now for the audience, what you see here, it's four people that believe in purpose. I have to say there are still business people that are not so much believing in purpose. And are not so much believing in the sustainability issue and in the social impacts that companies have. And that's part of that, you know, the problem of credibility. Nikhil, can I ask you, how do you make sure that your people and your company trust and believe your purpose statement and your purpose strategy?
I think so. I think the first thing we did was we built our purpose ground up. So I think about two and a half years ago, we had roughly 800 people participating in conversations to actually figure out why do we exist. The question was, if Go did not exist, what would happen? So it started with that. And I think we mapped a journey where all these 800 people and the 100 contractors we use were involved in our discussions beyond the broader stakeholders. So that actually helped us to just define a purpose where everybody contributed to it. The bigger objective was, we didn't want purpose to be a post, nice posters and words on the wall. And we actively worked towards that. In fact, you will not find our purpose even on our website today, but it exists in our hearts. So in order to do that, what we do is, we started with every quarter, we have what we call purpose weeks. We have conversation. 1 week, there's a conversation across the company where everybody participates, talks about our progress, talks about what can we do to live our purpose, our values. From that, we actually define projects that we'll implement over the next 3 to 6 months. For example, one of our values is obsess over customers. And as part of that, we said, look, today we want to have a promise where nobody can go to bed without internet. So that immediately became a project, a rallying cry. And now we have a metric where we actually, everybody can see how many customers are going to bed without internet. Not, we are not perfect, but the whole point is, by defining it and actually measuring progress, people start seeing that the organization is acting on their views, right? Then what we started doing is that we started using our purpose and our values as a lens to describe everything we do in our business. It became our language. We even so much so that we overhauled our performance reward systems. Today at Go, any employee can reward any other employee 25 euros, unlimited number of times in a year. All he has to do, or she has to do, is that essentially go into our company. We have a blog or a portal of sorts, and just in a very short description, explain why this employee has lived our values and our purpose. There's no questions asked. There's no worrying about who games the system. And the power of that is amazing, because it creates not only a peer pressure, but people see good examples of how your purpose is being lived. So this was a key element, not only just working at top down, but actually have a bottom up effect where every month, every week, people are seeing that the ideas they give are being implemented, and we are seeing progress along the metrics we have defined. And so essentially that's, and last but not least, is communications. I think one of the big things about purpose was actually making the company more transparent. Being a public company, it used to be like 10% of the company would know most of the information. We have changed that around. And it's not a massive act, but for example, every Friday I write a blog which talks about some key development or our results for the year or something somebody has done in the company to live our purpose. We have a 1 hour town hall every week where at least 30 to 40% of the employees attend, where for 15 minutes, we discuss a new project, a product launch, and then there's 45 minutes where all employees can ask questions anonymously. And as top management, we sit together and we actually answer those questions. So defining a purpose ground up, having projects which show measurable improvement month on month, and then actually having a open, transparent culture and communication is how I think one can build credibility around their purpose.
Yes, that's a really good explanation. Franco, same question for you.
Okay, so as I said, the first thing I worked on is the governance side. And like Nikhil is saying, I mean, communication is key. So from there, once we have the mindset all defined, my role was to communicate at all levels of the company. Now, you'd understand that a vast majority of our people are drivers and truckers and assistants and helpers. Yes, we have, of course, the administration block, and out of the administration block, we meet in monthly meetings. So 20% of the administration is involved in the actual business plan, which is a rolling 3 plan, and we do it every year, and there's 3 solid months of, you know, brainstorming and what we can do better and what we did right, and let's do it again, you know, and yeah, everything is circling around this We Are Orange hashtag, We Are Orange, that we coined a couple of years back. And that was a bit of a bold move, because you'd understand that our owners have had the orange color for 50 years. But it meant it's just a flagship color for them. What's in a color, so to speak? Discussing with our marketing people, and we said, but we need to get something out of, you know, something unique. And this was a bold move. I mean, Steve Jobs managed to change the dictionary meaning of Apple. And we said, why not? We are orange, you know? I mean, we're not, it's not a bold statement that will be like the Steve Jobs going global with that. So it's not our intention to change the dictionary meaning of orange, but the orange color. And when we're asked, but why do you say we are orange? Well, what's this hype? Believe me, this has filtered down to all employees, and this is what is used amongst them, even when showing camaraderie, even in a social event. This is the We Are Orange, you know, it's vibrant. But the essence of it is the meaning of what it stands for. And it stands it's the family values that we inherited from the brothers and from the founder of the company and from the third generation. And of course, the vast majority are not family members in management anymore. So the vast majority are non-family members, but with proper governance, there's equality. It's not, there's no concept or idea that because of a person is in management and belongs to the family, there's something more than, so there's equality, there's a strong understanding. And yeah, it's a challenge all the time because people do feel different because family is family then. But that sense of equality, you know, articulated amongst all employees, the vast majority that is not family feels at home anyway. So they do actually feel as part of the family in the same way. So it's been a journey. I think the turning point or the point that made people really believe what we're trying to do was this COVID. So with every tragedy, perhaps one can find also the opportunities. The fact that we lived our word, we left no one behind really and truly, we stopped no employment, we paid everyone every single cent, everybody worked wholeheartedly, they understood that they were part of a social mission, that they were bringing food on the table of people, medicines, pharmaceuticals, you know, so our people all felt this vibrant, this meaning to this We Are Orange, that it came out in the COVID times. And I think that was amazing. It was something that we didn't plan for, but it happened. And when it happened, you know, the wheat was separated from the chaff, and this mission that we've had over a number of years actually came to fruition. And I have to say, I'm very proud of all the people who work there, and we're quite a strong team. And I think even the people we serve, the communities we serve, they do understand that, you know, as I said before, if they're having anything on the table, if the table per se, that has been carried by us, by one of our people.
Right. Okay, thank you. In the meantime, questions came in from the audience. And the first question is one for Maria. The question is, and I think this one is for you because, you know, drinks company is in a transition. And the question is, how can an organization that did not have purpose at its heart first, do the shift, do the transition?
I think that first, for for a company not having a purpose, how can it do its shift? Well, I have to say that first, one needs to understand what purpose the company needs to have. So it's defining the purpose. And defining the purpose can be done in several ways. I believe that it's important to get feedback from all stakeholders when you define purpose. So it's important to listen to what your employees are saying, what the companies you represent are saying, what science is saying, and where the world is heading. I think if you understand all of these, then you need to define purpose, define the purpose for your company, and then you need to make sure that there is an action plan behind this purpose. Clear scientific objectives. I mean, I believe a lot in numbers. I believe a lot in measuring, because that is the only way that we can give tangible results. And then making sure that once you are setting your actions, you are defining your targets and setting in the timelines, you are communicating effectively, both internally and externally, in order to build trust in what you are doing and what you are achieving.
All right, thank you. As we said, we have a few minutes left. As we discussed in the beginning, if we talk about sustainability, then and if we ask ourselves what's at stake for humanity, it's not us going extinct, but it is about the risk we are willing to take to make the lives of our grandchildren and great grandchildren very miserable. And so, the question of does your business wants to help solve the sustainability issue is basically boils down to this. What is the risk that, are you willing to take the risk that, the life of your grandchildren and great-grandchildren might turn out to be really miserable? It's always fantastic if CEOs or business leaders, think about what they would say today to their great grandchildren of of tomorrow. Great grandchildren will be around 2100, and in 2100 we'll be in a world that limit global warming to 1.5%. Or we will be in a world of plus 3%, 3 degrees, 1.5 degree and 3 degrees. And that means that lives will be very, very miserable. So, two business leaders in this panel volunteered to write a letter to their great grandchildren, and which is fantastic. And I ask Maria first to read it out loud. Thank you very much, Maria.
Thanks, Wim. So, my dearest great-grandchildren, it is highly probable that when you read this letter, you would never have known me in person, but you must have formed an impression of me from the stories recounted to you by your parents and grandparents and from the legacy I would have left behind me. I hope you will feel proud and that you will feel equipped and compelled to achieve better. Today, I wanted to take a few minutes to share with you some of my thoughts. Please understand that as you read this, we may not always share the same ideas about the world, and that is okay. I believe that it is through open communication that we learn, grow, and understand one another. What is important is that you have in you a sense of pride and belonging in anything you do. Each of us has special gifts and talents, so embrace everything that is unique about you. As you grow up, you will come to know these talents and you will develop passions. It is important that you live a purposeful life and that you have dreams and goals that you want to accomplish. I started out my career thinking I was going to become a chemist, but then as a student placement at GSD, a company that produces beverages for the Coca-Cola company, changed my life. Eventually, I became the CEO of the company. This experience eventually led me to take other challenges in a cross-section of industries: retailing, hospitality, language tourism, airlines, insurance. I managed this through hard work by listening and learning from the people I encountered and the experiences I went through. And most importantly, by creating teams and by leading teams with purpose. The principles that always guided me through thick and thin, despite the hurdles, were integrity, honesty, passion, curiosity, and respect. Whatever choices you will be making in your lives, it is important to always be open to learning new things. Be curious about the people, the experiences, the events and discoveries taking place in the present, as well as the things that you can learn from the past. Let the past be inspirational to you, but let it create no constraints. It is this kind of awareness that will allow you to be happy and feel fulfilled, and guide you through a better world for you and those who will come after you. The issues facing my generation, and hence that had an impact on the functions I was leading, were diverse, from climate and reducing carbon footprint, to waste, trying to create a zero waste impact by working on collection and recycling, sugar reduction, obesity being one of the major killers of my generation, women, making women economically empowered, human rights, respecting for diversity, and water, replenishing Mother Earth with the water that we use. I try to do my part in all these areas, and I hope that somehow I would really have worked hard till my last hours to leave my impact in all of these areas, so that I would have truly contributed to the work done by my generation, and you can take on where my generation left it. Feel inspired by the results, learn from the mistakes that our generation made, and continue to make the world we live in a better place. I believe the best gift I can ever give you is to make sure you have a prosperous future and an even brighter world. I hope that you will also use your natural gifts and talents to make the world a better place. Do not ever let your fear of someone else's judgment get in the way of seeking help when you need it. You can make a difference no matter what path you choose in life. So that's my letter, Wim.
Thank you very much, Maria. I hope this was a useful session for the audience. Please write your own letter to your great-grandchildren, because you will have to think about your personal purpose. And as a business leader, you will have to think about the world that you want to leave behind and the risk you want to take for your family. Please do that. You will see that it will help you crystallize your thoughts and becoming very focused. Maria, Franco, Mark, and Nikhil, thank you very much for attending. I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for being honest and being, and explain in detail what you are doing. to install purpose and to fight climate change and the social inequality. Thank you for that. It's not, you know, it's not every day that you have business leaders open up and talk about that. And I want to thank the audience for attending. So thank you very much. Thank you all and good luck.